Addition and subtraction. That's what we're going to talk about this Wednesday night. I was fairly good at addition and subtraction as far as accuracy, perhaps because my mother and even my sister are accountants. But when it came to abstract math, that was a different story. That required a lot more work. But thinking about 2020, there's been a lot of additions and subtractions from our lives. That's the truth, isn't it? And somebody, a neighbor, told me it's a whole new landscape for people that have been working at home in the medical world, people seeking vaccines and cures for the coronavirus, dealing with the situations of eruptions in society, and also perhaps for some of you, some blessings, being home with family, some maybe downtime, renewal time that maybe in previous years in the jet plane speed that we sometimes traffic with our lives, maybe this has been a renewal year. But certainly there have been for just about everybody additions and subtractions. And I want to talk about that today, spiritually speaking. In order to live a successful Christian life, there are some things that we need to add, and there are some things that we need to subtract. To put it another way, Paul would say, the Apostle Paul, there are some things we need to put on, and there's some things we need to put off. So we're going to talk about that. The university I went to had a very faithful Greek professor. His name is Dr. Robert Grimacki, and I'm going to borrow some of his Greek expertise today. But the year before I came to the university, I was told and we had chapel at the university every day, and there was a faculty day. And one time he was the speaker, and he came out, and in those days you had to dress up, or many people dressed up to go to chapel, including the students. Really almost like church in one sense. But he came out in these old, baggy, old, dirty, grimy overalls like he'd been out working in the farm field. And he was he got up there and people were like, what in the world's he doing? But he was using a pictorial example. He took off the old clothes and underneath was his suit, tie, coat, shirt like I have on this evening. And he was making an illustration about where to put off the old and where to put on the new. So that's what I'm going to talk about today. Some things were to add and some things were to subtract, because the Christian life consists of Christ living his life through us. That's the successful Christian life. That's the main idea, what I want you to hold on to tonight. We're in Colossians chapter 3. If you want to take your Bible, let's go to Colossians chapter 3. And beginning in Colossians 3, it's one of the pastoral epistles, and it's very similar to Ephesians and Philippians, particularly Ephesians. So in Colossians, let me make another thought. In Ephesians, Paul's introducing the mystery of the church, that Christ is the head of the church. In Colossians, he's reemphasizing that Christ is the head, not only of the church, but the entire universe. Because there were a group called the Gnostic Judaizers that were teaching some false doctrines to the Colossian believers that were confusing many, and so Paul needed to clarify some important points. Colossians 3 is where I'm at, and he says, if you have been raised up with Christ, and so this is an assumed condition for believers. A genuine teacher wants to inform his people not only about what is wrong, but to guide them into what is right. And so there are two words that Paul sets forth, seek and to set. And this is the introduction to the things we need to add and the things we need to subtract. So as with any message, God needs to be the center of the message. And so that's Paul makes that point clear. Paul assumed the Colossians positionally were identified with Christ. So it's a first-class conditional clause, as my professor emphasizes. Be read this way. If ye have been risen with Christ, and you have. So there's a positional identification. If you're a believer, you've moved out of the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of light. All believers have died with Christ, we're buried with him positionally, and we've been raised with him. In fact, we're seated in the presence of Christ. He says that in Colossians 2, and here in Colossians 3, and in Romans 6, and Ephesians 2. In the redemptive program, God always sees the converted sinner in Christ, or a saint. Whatever Christ has done, he's done in the believer. I like that. Dr. Robert Grimacki emphasizes that. So this becomes real in the life of you at the time of your regeneration, but you and I have to appropriate that truth daily in order to live the victorious Christian life. So we should seek those things that are above. And I've often read that verse, and we don't know all that's above, but Paul says we know Christ is there. He's seated there. That means the work has been done. It's finished. And that's in contrast to the below things, to the Colossians. That would have been these legalistic, very rule-oriented, ascetic practices of these heretics. So we have our inheritance in heaven that can never fade away, according to Paul and Peter. Your believing loved ones that have passed on are there. God's glory is there. Christ is preparing your home there. And your identity is there. You're going to get a new name there. So that's all there, and we know Christ is there, and that's where we're going. So we're to seek what is going to last versus what is transient or passing away. So he says, seek, and then he says, set your mind. We seek what is above. That is, fix your life on Christ. Make sure that you are dwelling and your life is centered on that which is really important versus that which is passing away. Then the command is set your mind, and it's or literally set your affections, but it deals more with your mind than your feelings. In other words, keep on thinking. Be like-minded is what Paul said in Philippians, the same thought. Have this mind in you which was in Christ Jesus. So the object, if you look at verse 2, set your mind, that is your thinking, on things above, not on things of the earth. So we've already said that you're already identified in heaven. In fact, it says you're already seated with there positionally in Christ. You have a new name there. Your inheritance is there. So that's the focus. And there are reasons that we're to do that. First, he says you have died. In other words, your old life is what you were saved out of, or if you were saved when you were young, what you were saved from. You've been delivered from the ways of the world, and you are now in Christ. So, in fact, it says your life is hid with Christ. There's safety and security there, and what the unbelieving world does not see you as they may hear it from you, but one day it will be revealed when Christ is revealed. And he says, Christ is our life, verse 4. It's a wonderful truth. He's our life now. He's the bread from heaven by which we partake of spiritually. He's the living vine, we're the branch. We get our life in him. And then he goes on to say he's going to appear. And that means we're to look up rather than look down and get depressed or look around and be distracted. We're to look at him, and he's coming back for us to take us to be with him. We died with him. We rose with him positionally. We need to appropriate that truth in our life. And so when Christ returns, he's returning for you and me. And there's a great hymn, Glory to His Name, and that's really the idea here. We're going to be transformed from the corruptible, immortal body to one that will never get old, sick, or pass away, an eternal body to match the new condition of our soul. So now would you look again at verse 4 and read it. For Christ, who is our life, is revealed, and we will be revealed with him in glory. Now that's kind of the introduction. Now we come to the practical part of what we're to do. That is the foundation as the basis to what we're to do now as we live life on earth. All right. Here's a question for you, though. All right. In fact, I want to read something that I want to go back to something that I have in my notes from Dr. Robert Grimacki. And it really emphasizes the truth of this whole idea that we're different from the world. I'm quoting him. He says, a believer must differentiate between that which is beneficial and that which is detrimental to his spiritual health or her spiritual health. Let me repeat that. A believer must differentiate between that which is beneficial and that which is detrimental to your spiritual health. Now stop and think about that for a moment. I've reflected a lot my own thoughts on that. How can we seek and think about heavenly things? Now we know, we'd like to know a lot more, but we know the holy city is there, heaven, the streets of gold, Christ is preparing a home for us. A lot of things we could think about, but he is there, God is there, Holy Spirit's in us. But how can we think about things that are really important? It's really going to last. The Word of God's going to last. People are going to be eternal. We should invest there. What things hold us back? What earthly things hold us back? So this is what we need to think about. So a change in position should manifest a change in practice. And that's what Paul is saying. So now we talk about the old life and the new life, the things that were to put off and the things that were to put on, addition and subtraction, okay? The believer must willingly and actively overcome the desires of the sinful nature that is within us. So, I want you to think about this now, all right? Look with me at verse 5. Consider the members of your earthly body as dead to immorality, impurity, passion, evil desire, greed, which amounts to idolatry. Now, the King James has the word mortify, and I like that. Mortify. Now, I'm going to give you a truth here, okay? Think deep just for a moment. I mentioned this to our small group Bible study. There are good teachers that say, as a believer, we have both the old nature, what we were before we were a believer, and a new nature that God has given to us. And I believe that for many years. As I went to school, I heard both that teaching from professors, and then I was introduced to another teaching that says, when you're a believer, you're a new creation. You've been completely made new. The divine nature has been given to you. And as a result, your old self has been done away with. And Romans 6 does say your old self has been crucified with him. And the teaching that I was introduced to is that we no longer have an old self or an old nature. But the teaching I was taught that was not implying that you can reach a state of sinless perfection on earth. But what the battle was now is our body, our flesh. Now, somebody might say, well, that's just semantics. You're splitting hairs. And perhaps. But there's two different words. The old nature is never referred to in our struggle as a believer by Paul. It's always the flesh. The flesh can be used in different definitions. But I kind of resisted that truth, even argued with professors about that truth, but I actually came to believe that's what the Bible is actually teaching, that we've been completely made new and that our old nature is done away with. We're new. We have a new nature. But we're still battling the flesh, which is our old body, which sin tries to find a vehicle through our body, through the lust of the flesh, that's what the word is, or the world, or the enemy, and our flesh involves our psychological being and carryovers from what we were. Now, that's deep. I know that's perhaps you have to think about that a while. But to me, that meant a whole new picture of how I view the Christian life on the side of victory, versus kind of this good dog, bad dog struggle constantly going on. But nonetheless, good teachers believe both ways, and the battle is still real until we get to heaven. But here is how to have victory, and that's what I'm talking about today, all right? So, in fact, in Romans it says, reckon, or that is, consider, calculate yourself to be dead. Same word in Colossians, unto sin. So, and I'm going to, here's my professor that says we cannot eradicate the sin nature, but we can treat it as a morally impotent force. So that's the one view. I would say the old nature has been mortified or put to death, but we still battle the flesh. But either way, think deeply on that. Study the scriptures, but the victory is not in ourself. So no matter which side that you land on, if you think about that theologically, we cannot obtain victory in ourselves. That's the point. So we have the victory comes from beyond us, but within us through Jesus Christ. This is the victorious Christian life. He has come to live on the inside of us through the Holy Spirit. That's why the verse says, Christ who is our life. Now, I'm not going to go into great detail. These sins should be dead to the believer. If either they were formerly lived in or we were delivered from them. Fornication is the first word, deals with sexual immorality, both without and within the marital union. Then uncleanness means moral impurity of all forms, and we're bombarded with that from magazines to television to YouTube and your phone and everything. We just cannot escape it unless we put a filter over our mind and our eyes and our hearts. So this kind of uncleanness is a filthy mind full of sensuality, whether it's through suggestive thoughts, humor, etc. And this is why people are trapped into this in literature, movies, and pornography. It's caused by lust of the hearts, and it can lead to dishonor of our body. Inordinate affection is the next word. It means depraved passion, uncontrollable desire, or desire to use somebody else for our own selfish sensual gratification. This is a tough word for me. Evil concupiscence or evil Cupiscence. I probably said that wrong. You know, I got a little, that's an old English King James word. I call that, if you can pardon the humor, I call it evil Cupid. You know, we think of Cupid being that little pudgy angel that taps you with the wand and then you're magically in love, like we think about on Valentine's Day. To me, this is the parallel universe, the evil Cupid that whacks you upside the head so that you do evil. But the truth of the matter is, this means a wicked desire. In fact, in Isaiah, it talks about the cherubim angels and the seraphim angels. Ezekiel and Revelation talk about them. We'd like to know more, but basically the cherubim are those angels that protect the honor and glory of God. The seraphim angels, always associated with the burning coals, are they're searching out sin associated with the burnt offering. It's a little bit of a nuance there, but it means here evil desire, all right? So our, you know, that's really what it, in our modern language, would mean evil desire, wicked desire, physical desires within our personality. Now, by the way, God gives passions and desires. There's nothing wrong with these things if they're properly used. And this is the problem. The Colossians were saying, you know, browbeat your body, deny desires. Your body is really not, it's not even there. It's not important. Or the flip side of the Gnostics was do whatever you want with your body, because it's really the immaterial that's the only thing that matters. That was false heretical teaching. So that's why Paul was saying, no, it does matter what you do with your body. Your body's real. If you're a believer, it's the temple of the Holy Spirit. But so God has given us our personalities and desires. They are given and intrinsically good, but they become evil when they're motivated and executed for evil ends. That's the point. Covetousness was one of the things that Paul struggled with as an unbeliever. It means idolatry. By the way, anything that exalts itself above God becomes an idol, even in the life of a believer. That's why John said, little children, keep yourself from idols. Now, verse 6 says, for on account of these comes the wrath of God. For the unbeliever that doesn't accept Christ, divine judgment comes upon the people because they have become their own God. God is holy, God is love, but he does not overlook sin. He would not be God if he did. And his righteous displeasure is expressed in the wrath of God. His anger is not prejudice or partial. It is judicial. It's not temperamental. It's balanced with his holy being of mercy, compassion, and love. In fact, Habakkuk, the Old Testament prophet, said, God cannot condone sin. He said, O Lord, thou hast ordained them for judgment. Almighty God, you have established them for correction. Thou art of purer eyes than to behold evil. You cannot look upon iniquity. So God is constrained to judge it. He cannot be indifferent to it at all. His divine wrath is coming. He's patient and long-suffering. He wants people to put their trust in Christ. All right, so unless people are saved, judicial wrath will come upon those who do not receive the Lord. All right, let's move on. Now, the next verb, our next verse is verse 7. In them you once walked, and you were living in them. He's talking about people that had this lifestyle as unbelievers. So it's called the children of disobedience. They will experience this wrath. They are the sons of disobedience. Now, verse 7, they once walked in this lifestyle. Paul said in Ephesians, in time past you walked according to the course of this world. Now, addition and subtraction for the believer. But now, here's a transition, verse 8. Put them off. Subtract these things from your life. And he mentions several. Anger, wrath, malice, slander, abusive speech from your mouth. In other words, these are things you're going to feel. For many years, I was just victimized. Well, I say that. I yielded to whatever feelings I had. If I was in a good mood, I was fine. But if I experienced sudden feelings of anger or worry, I'd find myself yielding to those emotions. I was not yet mature to realize they're just emotions. And God is we're not subject to those things. We don't have to be, because of the indwelling Holy Spirit. Paul said elsewhere, walk in the Spirit, you will not fulfill the lust of the flesh. He didn't say you won't feel the lust of the flesh. When we're walking, that is controlled by the Spirit, we will not fulfill the lust of the flesh. And lust isn't just something sensual or sexual. It can mean any desire that goes the wrong way. All right, it can be coveting, it can be worry, it could be, you know, you're passionate about money, etc. It could be all sorts of things. All right, so here's the things we're to put off. This is the transition. And the imagery is clothing. That's why my professor used that in his sermon in the chapel. He put off these old clothes and he put on the new. All right. So the garments of righteousness are to be put on and the old rags of sin are to be discarded. Five sins. Anger is the first one. Look at verse 8. Same word as the wrath of God in verse 6. Anger in itself is a proper emotion if controlled by the Holy Spirit and exercised for holy reasons. We see a lot of uncontrolled anger in society, people justifying it, people probably being paid for it, people destroying property, lives, and I don't want to dwell on that. And people can use anger in a proper way. They can use it to bring about good legislation and other things. But here, for the unsaved man and even the carnal believer, it's an inward attitude of the flesh. It can be used wrongly. Wrath is the next word, closely associated with anger. It means white hot anger. It's uncontrolled rage, and it can be expressed through outburst of anger. In fact, one theologian, Carson, says this is anger. Anger speaks of the settled attitude, while wrath is the passionate outburst. Anger is kept in, wrath is let out. So when you look at those words, carefully notice verse 8 again. Put these things off or aside. Anger. All right, that's the inward inward attitude. It can be a seething attitude that just boils within somebody if they don't deal with it properly and express it appropriately. And then the next one is wrath, where it just it's without a control base on it. It's just explosion, all right? So malice is the general word for moral corruption or just moral, somebody put badness is really the truth of the matter. It's a personal animosity. It's malicious gossip. This can wreak havoc and spread like firebrand within the church. The enemy has used it. It can tear down families. It's people that talk behind somebody's back. It can destroy reputations. And so wickedness is the next word. It's the practice of sin. One acts with malice when he does wrong and even tries to justify it. When one acts with wickedness, he not only does wrong, he does it, she does it with pleasure. Romans 1 talks about that. Blasphemy can be directed, next word, toward God or man. Comes from two words, which means to speak and to injure somebody. It is both abusive words and it's slander. And people can definitely be torn to the frame by words. Words do hurt. Words can insult and just really destroy somebody's esteem and life. All right, filthy communication is the next word, or abusive speech from your mouth, and it really means just disgraceful speech. These are things we're to put off. In fact, he says in verse 9, do not lie to one another, since you have laid aside, past tense, the old self. And this is another basis for my point that the old nature has been, past tense, put aside. And yet there's an active part that we're to cooperate with the Spirit. We're just not lay down as we're just programmed robots and we don't do anything. No. Lying is an obvious one, but it means, you know, certainly within the relationships within the church and your family, it means just what it says. Lie means to tell a deliberate untruth, to create a wrong impression by revealing a partial truth, or to distort the facts by exaggeration. So Paul elsewhere in Ephesians said, put away lying and speak the truth, everyone with his neighbor, for we're members one of another. This is part of the old life that is to be put off. Seeing that you have put off. It's a Greek aorist participle. It explains why we are to stop lying. At conversion, we have positionally put off. We pass from death to life, and now we're in Christ. The unsaved life is described as the old self with his deeds. This is contrary to the new life. So, now, verse 10 is the transition. We've gone from, as a believer, what you're to put off, subtract, lay aside, and now what you're to add, put on to your life. Verse 10, and have put on the new self, the new nature. Divine nature has been given to us by God, according to Peter. So what he's saying here, at regeneration, we're to put off, and now we're to put on. So, by the way, the new self is being renewed. So it's interesting to me, it has been given to us at conversion, but it is renewed and day by day. In other words, every day we live is a day to grow closer to the Lord and have a more deeper, intimate relationship with Him. That's why Paul said, I know Him, I know knowledge of Him, but I want to know the power of His resurrection. So that's what Paul is saying, and really what he's emphasizing here. So as we look at this verse, and it is not the old made new or the old reform. Even Jesus said, you don't put old wineskins over the new. So you've been made new. The new has no connection whatsoever with the old. It is the life of a person that never existed before regeneration occurred. So this is why just merely trying to reform yourself isn't going to cut the mustard. It isn't going to make it. You know, it's not a New Year's resolution, because eventually it will falter and fail. And this is why the teaching of the ascetics and the Gnostics and the days of the Colossians is, you know, we have the same type of groups today that will try to do the same thing. And merely trying to, you know, prep yourself up by just merely going to church or going through religion is not going to do it. It is a renewed life that is by the Holy Spirit. And the goal is not only knowledge, but it is a personal, intimate relationship to know Christ in a deeper way. So as we're looking at this verse, and I'll just touch base on verse 11 in light of what's going on in society. Paul says this is, it's an understood, the words aren't in the original, but it's understood. This is a renewal which has no, he really says, no Greek or Jew, uncircumcised or circumcised, barbarian or Scythian, slave or freeman, for Christ is all and in all. And this is interesting. When you look at this, four divisions of humanity are given, although there are others such as male and female, but race is indicated by the couplet Greek or Jew. All non-Jews, including those of both Greek and Roman nationality, in those days were classified as Greek. Religion is seen in the contrast, circumcision nor uncircumcision. And all religions, apart from Christianity, do not embrace the Bible, but Judaism, with all of its Jewish adherents and Gentile proselytes, and they were prominent in that day that Paul was writing, that's what he was addressing. And so they were part of the pagan world. Culture. They have a lot of talk about culture today. It's involved in the two words barbarian and Scythian. Those were those that were ignorant of the culture or the language of the Greeks and Romans. And the Scythian or the Scythian, however you pronounce it, was the lowest type of barbarian in that day. Very crude and rough people. They were the nomads who roamed the Black and Caspian seas. Social status is revealed in the words bond or free. The Roman world in the first century was equally divided between freemen and slaves. And so it's very interesting that despite classifications, the Bible was radical in saying we're all equal in Christ, period. That says a lot in light of what is being emphasized today. All right, moving on. So he says in verse 12 now, and as those who have been chosen of God, that's believers, holy, that is set apart and elect. So God sovereignly selected us in Christ before the foundation of the world that we should be holy and without blame before Him. That's Ephesians 1:4. So at a time and a point in history you were born, there was a time where you believed on Christ, you were conceived by the Holy Spirit, convicted that is, but in the sense He came into your life. And you were drawn to the Son and the Father, and the Holy Spirit was, if you will, birthed into you when you experienced the new birth. So we're now set apart. We're saints. We're permanently set apart from the world for God, for His unique purpose for us. We're beloved. What a great truth. Now, here are the list of virtues that we're to put on. We've reviewed the things that we're to put off: anger, wrath, malice, slander, abusive speech, lying, and he reminds us we've been renewed. The foundation, going back to the beginning of the chapter, you're a believer, you have been risen with Christ, you're literally positionally there, one day you're going there in person, He's your life now, and you're going to be revealed with Him in glory. That's the foundation. So therefore consider yourself dead to any former lifestyle of the world, but there's still emotions and feelings that we deal with. Attitudes, there are negative, there are ones that can be used negative or positive. And he says the negative form are to put off subtract them, and now the positive, the things that we're to add. I'm going to go through them quickly. The word bowels of mercies in the Greek really means a heart of compassion. In other words, this referred to having a soft, teachable, vulnerable attitude. Are you teachable? Are you fixed in your attitude that your way is the only way? Be teachable, even when it comes to Scripture. Think of the mentors in your life that have been great teachers, your parents, pastors, professors, coaches, etc. So this is deep feelings of concern for the needs of others. When you have compassion, some of you have this by your sheer personality, but we're to put this on as a part of our life. Think about that. Kindness is grace in action. It is a sweet disposition. That's the next word. It is a desire for good. So in other words, compassion, you feel for the needs of others, and kindness, you put it into action. It's also part of the fruit of the Spirit. Humbleness of mind is the next word, and that's what it means, humility. And so Peter said, humble yourself in the sight of the Lord, and he will lift you up. God gives grace to the humble. Peter says that. Paul says we're to have humility, a teachable spirit, so that we can serve others. It is certainly the mind of Christ, Philippians 2:5. Meekness is the next word. It means the spirit of quiet submission. It is strength under control. Paul was described as meek. He was certainly a strong leader. Moses was meek. He was definitely the leader of Israel. And Jesus was described as meek. He's the Messiah of the world. They were not weak by being described as meek. This is not a psychological timidity or you lay down and be a floor mat and let everybody walk under you. It's power under control. It's the ability to express the right thing in the right way at the right time. It sometimes is tough love spoken. It is sometimes manifested in action that way. But it is the opposite of insubordination. It is the opposite of people that are rebelling against authority that we see going on now. Long-suffering is the next word. It means wrath that is put far away. It is when it's a manifest of your flesh, it is a real inward wrath. All right? Spirit-controlled believer with this, you put a distance between this and the enemy. It doesn't mean, again, that we don't feel those things we talked about that you're to put off in an inappropriate way, but long-suffering means exactly that. There's a long distance between you and yielding to that in an inappropriate way. Practically speaking, when you're long-suffering, that is, when you have a patience, perseverance, you put up with people that try your patience. You don't have a quick temper. You have a long-suffering attitude. Forbearing one another, and that goes right along with it. Listen, if we have compassion for people that God gives us the Holy Spirit, and we want to do good for people, and we're humble and teachable, and Paul says you even in Philippians, you want to consider other people even better than more important than yourself, then certainly you'll want, as a byproduct of that, you will have a long suffering. That is, you will patiently put up with people and you'll forbear them, which means you tolerate people that irritate you. And let's be honest, we do have people that irritate us. We you know, there are personalities that can rub us the wrong way, right? So when you look at this, that's what he's saying. These are things that we're to put on. So I'm drawing this to a conclusion. As a result of this, when you look carefully, look at the verse. Now, if we're going to have patience, we're going to bear with one another or forbear with one another, then you're going to forgive one another. It's the greatest, it's the climax of the virtues. These are the things we're to put on. Think about this. Who of us is worthy of the forgiveness of God? He's given us freely and lovingly forgiveness once and forevermore. So we're to have this toward one another. A vertical forgiveness that we have with God should exhibit in a horizontal forgiveness with one another. And the word charity sums it up. It is the love that it ties and binds all these other virtues together. Without love, and I think that's why Paul put it last, the other things are not going to be outshoots that we're to put on. Love is distinctively Christian. Oh, people can write about it in love songs of all different sizes and shapes and varieties of musical styles, but and poetry and literature and movies and etc. But this love has its source in God. God gave with the result that people could reject his love. God so loved that he gave his son. So, as I draw this to a climax and close, look with me at verse 15. Love is the bond of unity. Now he says in verse 15, let the peace of Christ, verse 16, let the word of Christ, the word let it, these things happen in you as you allow Christ within you to control your life. This is the life that wins when you let Christ do all these things in your life. All these things will be a natural outflow when you are walking in the Spirit, when Christ, who is your life, is controlling you. Let the peace of Christ rule in your heart. We have peace with God if you're a believer, but this is the peace of God. Its character comes from the triune God, the Father. Philippians 4, the peace of God, let it keep you and free from anxiety. Jesus said, my peace I give unto you. And the Holy Spirit's fruit is the peace. That's part of it. So it all comes from the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. In the midst of circumstances which can create worry and anxiety, this protects our heart and our mind. It is a ruling peace. And the next word, let it rule in your hearts, because you've been called into one body. And he says, be thankful. And then he says, verse 16, let the word of Christ, this is the Bible. It's one thing to, you know, to think about it, but let it be at home in your life. Let the word have free access to every part of your life. Let it dwell richly in you. Highly appraise it, prize it, and appreciate it. And finally, let everything you do, verse 6, 17, be done for the glory of God. When we put these things off and we put on what God wants us to, we will be living for the glory of God. Let's close in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you today that we have life in you. We've moved from the sphere of darkness to the kingdom of your dear Son. We're in his world, in his universe, and now we're going to one day be with you forever and ever. Glory to your name. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Hello, church family. I want to remind you of our next video stream will be Sunday morning at 10:30 at arthurchristian.church/live. Tune in and let us worship together.